smell of an old book. It's a great smell indeed, which is why I enjoy flipping through the beautiful pages of Harmsworth Natural History. And it also makes for an interesting read, because we get to see what science used to be like, what used to be at the top of the scientific community's game. What interesting, and maybe weird facts did they used to think? So get ready to curl up with a good book, because we're gonna get started looking into the world of Harmsworth Natural History and the macaws. So Harmsworth Natural History was published in 1910. Let's take a quick look just to get us in the mood of what was going on in that year, just so we can get a bit of perspective, really.
Starting back home in my neck of the woods, D.W. Griffith directs In Old California, a silent film, and the first film shot in the California village of Hollywood. And here in the UK, just after 9 years on the throne, King Edward VII dies in London. And in the scientific community, in 1910, US geneticist Thomas Hunt Morgan establishes the chromosome theory of inheritance through his study of the fruit fly.
So what does Harmsworth Natural History have to say on macaws? Well, they're under the chapter titled Typical Parrots, which is then further divided into different sections. Let's first start off looking at the section appropriately titled Typical Macaws.
It reads, of the 14 recognized species, a few of the better known will alone be mentioned. Among these, the red and blue macaw is one of the handsomest. In size, this splendid bird attains a total length of 3 feet. Nearly 2 of which are taken up by the tail. Its range is large, extending from Mexico to Guyana and the Amazon Valley. In marked contrast to the above is the coloring of the blue and yellow macaw. This species, which is smaller than the last, is also widely distributed in tropical America, ranging from Panama to the Amazon Valley. All the macaws of this genus are denizens of the dense forest of tropical America, associating in flocks and feeding on fruits, seeds, and nuts. They all nest in the hollows of trees, which they enlarge according to their requirements. Most of the macaws can be readily tamed and will live in captivity for long periods. They are, however, but poor talkers and never give up their pernicious habit of screaming. Moreover, although properly tamed birds seldom attempt to bite adults, many of them cannot safely be trusted where there are children.
So what holds true today? Have some things changed? Let's take a look.
So it first mentions the red and blue macaw, which is now better known as the scarlet macaw. It mentioned this bird gets to a total length of 3 feet. However, most sources say about 2 feet, 8 inches. But who's counting? However, since 1910, the range of the scarlet macaw has drastically decreased. Their range throughout Mexico and Central America has drastically declined. In fact, they're completely extinct in El Salvador. It is estimated that the Central American population is no more than 4,000 individuals. However, the South American population still remains strong in the Amazon basin. That brings us to the blue and yellow macaw, also known as the blue and gold macaw. Harmsworth Natural History said that the blue and yellow macaw was smaller than the scarlet, and that's not quite right. Turns out the blue and yellow macaw weighs about 45 ounces and is about 33.5 inches long, whereas the scarlet macaw comes in at 33.1 inches long and weighs up to 39.3 ounces, so a smidgen smaller. Harmsworth said that macaws eat fruit, seeds, and nuts. And well, that's true, but there's more to that story. They also eat flowers, leaves, and stems of plants. They also like to throw in a bit of protein, like insects and snails. Some parrots even consume soil. That's right, geophagy. Who knew? A study in 2017 looked to find out why the parrots do this, what's driving this behavior, and their results suggested that the clay may give parrots the nutritional boost they need to rear their young. This was no ordinary study. With over 20,000 hours of parrot observations stretching over 13 years, they truly did do their research. Parrot geophagy is concentrated in moist tropical forests, where sodium, which is quite vital for both muscle contraction and nerve function, is washed from the ecosystem, except where it's stored in hard clay. Now get this, the clay lakes of the Amazon typically contain sodium levels 40 times greater than the parrot's plant food. So with sodium missing from their diet, it's no wonder during times of stress like breeding season that they eat clay.
There's also a section titled Blue Macaws, which is separate from the typical parrots that we just looked at. Let's see what they have to say in this bit.
The blue macaw from central Brazil is the best known representative of a small genus characterized by the general color of the plumage, being blue both above and below. In marked contrast to the prevailing azure, stands out the yellow of the naked skin surrounding the eye, and also present at the base of the lower half of the beak. The black beak is of unusually large size, even for a macaw, and the feet are blackish. The blue macaw is a somewhat rare species, and although inhabiting the dense tropical forest affected by other macaws, it is said to differ markedly in regard to its breeding habits.
Is the blue macaw somewhat a rare species still? Let's check it out.
Today, they are known as the hyacinth macaw and happen to be both the largest and the heaviest macaw species, coming in at 39.4 inches tall and weighing up to 3.7 pounds. They also have a wingspan of more than 4 feet. The breeding habits aren't as different as they made it seem. Pairs mostly nest in hollow trees, although sometimes in holes or caves. And yes, their beaks are huge, but it's for good reason. It's because they love to eat large palm nuts, which are quite tough to break into. And sadly, they are somewhat a rare species. In fact, the IUCN Red List classifies the hyacinth macaw as vulnerable to extinction.
So this brings us to the story of the Spix macaw. Now, that name might sound familiar to you, and if I show you a picture, you may recognize it as our friend Blue from the movie Rio. Now, spoilers if you haven't seen the movie, Blue is one of the last of his kind, and he's brought down to Brazil to meet Jewel. And the hopes are that they will breed and create more Spix macaws. A rather entertaining journey takes place along the way, and it ends in hope. But how true is that compared to the real life story of the Spix macaw? Is it truly as hopeful as the movies make it seem?
The Spix macaw was named after Johann Baptista von Spix, who collected the first specimen in northeastern Brazil in 1819. Like many other parrot species, they faced a variety of threats, like habitat loss, invasive predators, and the pet trade. The smallest of the blue macaws, the Spix macaw is also the rarest parrot in the world. They have been considered extinct in the wild since the year 2000, and today only around 160 birds exist in captivity. Luckily, organizations like the Association for the Conservation of Threatened Parrots is hard at work trying to coordinate a breeding program as well as develop a suitable habitat in Brazil for reintroduction. I do hope that someday, through collaboration and cooperation, the Spix macaw will someday return safely to the wild.
So, do you think the Spix macaw can make a comeback? Are you feeling hopeful? Give this video a thumbs up if you are. Be sure to tune in next week when we dive back into Harmsworth natural history to take a look at the wonderful group of birds known as hornbills. Just in time for Valentine's Day. You can't get more romantic than hornbills. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to check out my playlist on the history and folklore of spooky animals, which you can see down in the description below. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.